The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Praise be to God. Hallelujah. Good evening, families. It's good to be with you all again. To God be the glory. I just want to thank God for all of you who tuned in and logged into our Facebook page to unite with us and be with us and hang out with us for communion. Again, I know earlier this year, I can't really say we were planning to have communion service on today, but I felt impressed and led the Holy Spirit to do this on today. To God be the glory. I know in many circles, not to sound judgmental at all, but I know a communion is something that we do on a regular basis. Amen. Even the Lord Jesus Christ said to us, as often as you do it in remembrance of him. But I'm sure many of you know that we can do something over and over and over again to the point whereas it can become ritualistic. And as a result, begin to lose its meaning and lose its impact. To God be the glory. And this is something I did not want to happen for tonight. And again, so it was impressed upon me and in my spirit to do communion with the family, not out of tradition because it's Good Friday, not out of ritual, but because we indeed need to commune with God, Lord. And this amazing, challenging, oh my God, troublesome season we are in, what better time than now to commune with God? For those who go to First Calvary, you've often heard me say so often, it's better to pray in those moments where things are well than to wait till things are bad to start to pray. And so as we get together and gather together this evening for communion, Lord have mercy, understand, make no mistake, this is not about a ritual, it's not about a mere tradition, but it's about an encounter. A divine encounter with God. Personally speaking, again, I can't say I know all of what's going to happen, but I do believe, because this was pressed upon my spirit, that God wants to do something supernatural in the lives of those who partake. You can call me crazy, call me foolish, but I am one of those people that still believe in miracles, signs, and wonders. I am one of those people who still believe that when you eat of his body and you drink of his blood, supernatural things can happen. And so I'm believing God that as we partake in communion on tonight together as family, God is going to do some awesome things. I'm believing we're going to hear reports of healing. I'm believing we're going to hear reports of deliverance. I believe we're going to hear signs and hear testimonies of signs and miracles and wonders. Again, I know I asked God to do some stuff through this communion. And I just believe he heard me. And I believe he's going to do it. As a matter of fact, I believe a much was in his heart already before I even prayed. Lord have mercy. And I believe his leading me to ask for certain things in prayer was for Jason to catch up with his will, not for him to catch up with mine. And so again, as we partake on tonight, I believe something divine is going to happen. I'm believing God for a kingdom encounter, not just in my life, not just for my family, but for you and for yours. To God be the glory. So I want to just share a few things. I did jot down a few points. To God be the glory. I don't call myself preaching per se, but then again, I don't know how this is going to come out. But I do want to share something with you before we eat and before we drink. So again, I'm not going to keep you long tonight. Just want to share some words of, encouragement, inspiration, and consideration and meditation. To God be the glory. And prayerfully, it blesses you. And then we'll eat and drink together. Amen. Just bow your heads with me. Father God, in Jesus' name, I thank you. I bless you. I honor you. I glorify you, God, for being awesome and amazing. And I pray, Lord God, for your blessing and your favor and your anointing as I expound on these words. God, forgive me of faults, failures, and shortcomings in the name of Jesus, not just me, but all of us. And we pray, Lord God, that what's spoken can go to every ear and every heart in such a way where you are glorified and we are edified. That anointing makes preaching and teaching effective, life-giving, and life-changing flow even now in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. And so if you have your Bibles in the book of Mark chapter 15, Book of Mark, chapter 15, to God be the glory, verse 37. Book of Mark 15, verse 37, just one verse. And Jesus cried with a loud voice and gave up the ghost. And Jesus cried with a loud voice and gave up the ghost. Again, this is an interesting subject, and if I had to pick a subject or a topic, I just want to use briefly for thought, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. To God be the glory. Praise be God. I pray you all are seeing this. Okay, we may need to kind of adjust some things here, so I'm going to let my son just adjust the camera. To God be the glory. And using for a subject, I can't breathe. Again, I understand, all of you, that tonight is an amazing night where we are able to come before his table. Truly, this is an honorable moment. It's an awesome moment. It's a glorious moment, a memorable moment, while at the same time, a solemn moment. It's a somber moment and reflective moment. Solemn, somber, and reflective, because when you come to his table, you can't come to it without considering what it cost him for you to arrive at it. Understand, because tonight the table is not empty. Hallelujah. The elements on it came at a heavy cost. A heavy price had to be paid in order to prepare this table we're about to partake in. The elements of it did not come for free. But again, it came at a price, a costly sacrifice. For it is not the mere unleavened bread or the fruit of the vine on the table, but blood is on the table. A body is on the table. And it had to be slain before it could be put on the table. For the preparation, power, and purpose of this table came when our Savior concluded within himself, I can't breathe. Pastor, I don't understand. What do you mean by when you say our Savior concluded within himself, I can't breathe? I don't see that phrase anywhere in the scripture. What I'm saying here, family, is in order for us to get to the table and partake of the elements on it, Jesus had to come to a conclusion and an ultimately a decision to take his last breath, allowing none to follow after it. Understand the statement, I can't breathe, is not the result of the inability to breathe. But in order to save me, in order to rescue me, in order to deliver me, in order to redeem me, in order to restore me, Jesus had to make a decision not to breathe. Did not Jesus say, therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again? No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. If he kept on breathing, then I would be lost. If he kept on breathing, then I would be weary. If he kept on breathing, then I would be sad. If he kept on breathing, I would be broken. I would be bound, and I would be shattered. If he kept on breathing, then I would have no real joy. If he kept on breathing, then I would have no sense of peace whatsoever. If he kept on breathing, my life would be empty. My destiny would not be realized, and my ending would be worse than my beginning. If he kept on breathing, my purpose would have no meaning at all. If he kept on breathing, my ending again would be so awful that my life would be worthless. My heart would be hopeless. My soul would be helpless, and my spirit would be faithless. He had to stop breathing so I could start breathing. When Jesus said, if it be possible, Let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Somewhere in between, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. And nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. A conclusion had to be drawn. A decision had to be made that if I keep on breathing, then you won't get another chance. If I keep on breathing, then you'll be lost forever. If I keep on breathing, then death will keep its sting. If I keep on breathing, the grave would hold on to its victory. If I keep on breathing, captivity would not be led captive. If I keep on breathing, they'll never be complete in me. If I keep on breathing, they'll never be buried with me in baptism. If I keep on breathing, they'll never be risen in me through faith. If I keep on breathing, they'll never be quickened together with me. If I keep on breathing, their trespasses and their sins will never be forgiven. If I keep on breathing, the handwriting of ordinances against them will never be blotted out nor taken away. If I keep on breathing, the principalities and powers will never be spoiled. Either I stop breathing or they'll never get a chance to. And so, to get his body on the table, he let them take him from judgment hall to judgment hall. He let them blindfold him and then strike him on the face and then mock him by saying, prophesy, who hit you? He let them whip him and beat him all night long. He let them pluck out his beard. He let them beat him beyond recognition. He let them place a crown of thorns on his head. He let them strap on his shoulders an 80 to 100 pound wooden beam. He let them march him through the streets of Jerusalem, mocking him, spitting on him, and kicking him. He let them drive 7-inch long nails, 1 centimeter wide, into his wrist. He let them, hell, my God, nail him in his right hand and nail him in his left hand. And then he let them suspend him up in the air as he dangled when they took that wooden beam and attached it to an upstanding pole. He let them put nails in his feet. And there he hung. But this is where things had to shift. Because there was nothing more physically that they could do to him. Everything that they could do physically had been done by this point. But yet, he was still breathing. When the cross was erected upright, tremendous strain fell on his wrists, arms, shoulders. This very hanging would lead to the dislocation of his elbows and his shoulder joints. With his arms being held upward and outward, the rib cage became fixed in an inspiratory position, thus making it extremely difficult for our Savior to exhale and impossible for him to take a full breath. Whew, I can't breathe. Jesus would only be able to take very shallow breaths, giving more understanding possibly to why he only spoke short statements while hanging on the cross. The shallowness of his breathing caused small areas of his lungs to collapse. And as a result, the oxygen could not sufficiently get to his lungs. And the carbon dioxide was not allowed to escape his lungs, thus throwing him into a condition that we call respiratory acidosis. I can't breathe. Fluid builds up in his lungs under the stress of insufficient oxygen and acidosis. The heart becomes stressed now, and it begins to fail. The cross forced his arms to be pulled upward. This caused his chest muscles that's needed for breathing to stretch beyond their capacity. While at the same time, these very same muscles were simultaneously being opposed by his weight. This made his breathing painful and difficult. as painful breathing developed and the pain in the wrists and the arms increased from hanging, Jesus began to push up with his feet, lifting his body in effort to ease the pain in his arms and catch some sort of breath. But in doing so, the weight of his body increased in his feet, thus increasing the pain in his feet, for the 7-inch nails were still there. Pain and cramps began to shoot up his legs, and when it became unbearable, Jesus began to slump down, thus reigniting the strain on his wrists, shooting shockwaves of pain up his arm, stretching his chest muscles, and painful, difficult breathing would again ensue, thrusting our Savior in this vicious, vicious cycle of pain and shortness of breath and torment. My God, I can't breathe. Eventually, during this tumultuous cycle, Jesus became overcome with fatigue, overwhelmed by exhaustion, and overtaken by excruciating pain. Thus, he could no longer lift his body. The muscle that he used for breathing became paralyzed, and eventually, he suffocated and died. A coroner's assessment will report to you that the most likely mechanism of his death in the crucifixion was suffocation. My God. But I need to tell you all tonight as we get ready to partake of the table. Suffocation was not the real cause of his death. My God. While there is accuracy in those components and those theories in causing the death of our Lord, I do not believe they were the final cause of his demise. Again, let me remind you that Jesus said, no man taketh my life, but I lay it down. And if I lay it down, I have the power to take it back up again. It was not respiratory acidosis that took his life. It was not the loss of blood that brought about his downfall. Painful breathing did not choke him to death. But when he said, it is finished, into your hands I commit my spirit, he took his last breath, offered it up, and laid down his life. The ghost was not taken from him. It was not forced from him, but he let go of the ghost and he gave it up. His death occurred by giving himself up, taking his last breath, then deciding not to breathe. And Jesus cried with a loud voice, and he gave up the ghost. He decided not to breathe. In order for me to come before this table, he had to stop breathing. That's why we're here tonight, because our Lord, our Savior, and our King stopped breathing. And he stopped breathing for you. He stopped breathing for me. Philippians 2 and 5 says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, and every tongue confess that he is Lord. Matter of fact, let me read that last part again. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven and of those on the earth and of those under the earth. Nobody can escape this profession. No one can escape this confession. That every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Family, as we make ready to partake of communion tonight, I need you to reflect on the understanding that he stopped breathing. He chose to stop breathing. He had to will himself to stop breathing. And he did that for you and for me. Before we eat and before we drink, I don't know, there may be someone tonight who has not committed their life to Jesus. You can do that now before we eat and drink. All that I just got done saying, those few points I shared, he did all of that for you. Being whipped, being beaten, nails in his hands, nails in his feet, being pierced in his side, a crown of thorns placed on his head for you. His back was whipped so badly that I believe you could actually see down to his ribcage. He did all that for you. I don't understand, Pastor, why did he have to suffer all that to save me? Because of wrath and judgment that was intended for us. He stepped in the way and he took it so that we wouldn't have to. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And so for all of our sins, that debt had to be paid. We just couldn't afford to pay it. I'm just glad that he could. And he did it by shedding his blood, bowing his head, and ceasing to breathe so he could die. Praise God. The Bible says in Romans 10 and 9, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. If Jesus is not your Lord or you have not committed yourself unto him, I'm not saying if you believe in Jesus. I'm not talking about that. If you have not given your life to him in commitment, I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer with me. Lord, I confess that I'm a sinner and I've done wrong. But I believe you died for my sins and you rose from the grave. And I believe you are the Son of God. And because of my confession and because of my belief, I am now saved. Thank you for saving me and setting me free. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer with me, to God be the glory, you are saved. You are his beloved, and you have access to who he is and all that he can do. Welcome to the kingdom, and welcome to the family. To God be the glory. Well, family, I'm going to enter to the act of communion at this time, and I know I shared a few days ago that, again, I understand we're under some constraints right now, and perhaps you didn't have any crackers or bread in your house, or maybe you didn't have any grape juice. It's totally fine. It's totally okay. And I don't care if you use saltine, I don't care if it's a Ritz or wheat bread or flat bread, pita bread, whatever. Praise be to God, whether you have juice or whether you have water, it's okay. I'm going to pray over it, and we're going to consecrate it unto the Lord, and we're going to believe God for his supernatural blessing as we partake in communion together. To God be the glory. In the book of 1 Corinthians, the 11th, verse. Praise God. 1 Corinthians, the 11th verse, beginning at verse 23. Paul is talking. And he says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as oft as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come.
Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Praise God. I'm going to pray over the communion elements, and so I'm going to just ask you, just get your meal before you. To God be the glory, whatever it is, whatever you got. We bless God for it. I'm going to pray over it, and we're going to believe God's supernatural blessing and favor over it, and that he would transform that thing from that which is natural to that which is spiritual. To God be the glory. And that as we eat and drink together, whatever our supernatural need is, or whatever God wants to do for us personally as well as collectively, that thing will happen and occur and manifest in our lives. Praise God. Let's bow our heads and bless our tables. Father God, in Jesus' name, we thank you. And we bless you, God, for doing all things well. God, what you have done in our lives is nothing short of amazing. And we give you all the glory and on all the praise for it. As we make way, Father God, to partake in this communion, we do so deliberately and intentionally. And as these elements lie on the table, we ask your blessing over them. Sanctify, purify, not only for nourishment and strength to the body, but God, we pray that you would bless it in such a way that what is natural becomes supernatural. That what is natural becomes spiritual. And whatever this communion needs to do in our bodies, in our hearts, in our minds, in our thought life, God, in our families, in our spirit, in our soul, whatever this communion needs to do, let it do just that. Lord, we pray your supernatural blessing and influence over the elements on our table, that when we eat it and drink it, it ushers us, Lord God, into a divine encounter with you, to your praise, your honor, and your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Praise God. I'm going to pray just one more prayer, and I'm going to ask that everybody, believer, praise God, everyone's going to eat and drink. I know you're saved, I know you're a believer already, but you just heard me read that if we partake of this communion unworthily, Lord, have mercy. That's the reason why many are sickly and weak among us, and many sleep. And so I want to lead us in a prayer of repentance. To God be the glory. And I cannot make you mean it. All I can do is lead you in it. But I want you to pray this prayer with me before we eat and before we drink, for his praise, honor, and glory. Just bow your heads one more time and repeat after me. Father, I confess I've made some mistakes, but I want to be right. And I want to be clean. Forgive me of my sins, my faults, my failures, and my shortcomings. And bless me and grace me to partake of this communion with clean hands and a clean heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. I'm going to ask my wife to come in and join me. To God be the glory. And you can take one. Let's give some to my kids. Praise be to God. And I do want to encourage, amen. You just heard me say I'm giving some to my kids. I encourage parents are going to give communion to the children, that their children understand who Jesus is and what he has done, and that those children, in a way that they understand, have accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior. This is not a snack just designed to keep them quiet or just let them join in. It's a deliberate meal and an intentional meal. Praise be to God. And if your children have accepted Christ as their Savior, indeed I want to encourage them to partake. Praise be to God. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Eat it in remembrance of him." his precious blood, shed for the remission of your sins. Drink it in remembrance of him. Bless God. And if you believe, praise be to God, that God has blessed you in partaking in his communion. To God be the glory. If you don't mind, wherever you're at, just lift your hands. Give God glory. Give God praise. Give God honor for the things he has done, the things he is doing, and the things he is going to do. I receive his healing. I receive his deliverance. I receive his breakthrough. I receive his blessing. I receive his favor. I receive his supernatural encounter for my life, for my family, and for yours. Thank you, oh God, for blessing us on tonight. Thank you, Lord God, for this awesome communion. Thank you, Lord God, for giving us your precious son to die on the cross for the redemption of our souls. Thank you, Lord God, for forgiving our sins and holding us close unto you. I thank you, Lord God, for all of those who joined in with us on tonight to partake in this blessed, sacred communion, Lord God. Your blessing and your favor be upon them, their household, and their families. And Lord God, what they touch, cause it to prosper. We pray your covering, Lord God. We pray your provision. We pray your prosperity, Lord God. And we pray your power, your anointing, your authority, and your glory, and your favor over them all. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Family, I love you. I thank God for you. Please, by all means, tune in and log in. Praise be to God for this coming Sunday morning, for Resurrection Sunday. There is a word from the Lord. To God be the glory. We plan to be online at 11 a.m. To God be the glory. God bless you. Go in peace, and the Lord be with you. Love you.